To the Lord alone. Why don't you stand with us today? Thanks for being here in worship. Psalm 96:2 says, sing to the Lord, bless his name, tell of his salvation from day to day. That's what we're here to do this morning, to declare the glory of the Lord. Let's worship him together. Sing with me, to the King.
To the King of glory and light, all praises to the only giver of life. The gates are open wide, we worship you.
Yes, Lord.
Sing. Come see what love has done, amazing. He bought us with his blood, our Savior. The cross has overcome, we worship you.
Shout it out, Hosanna.
Hosanna, Jesus. same power that rolled the stone away, the same power alive in us today. King Jesus, we call upon your name, no other names. The same power that rolled the stone away, the same power alive in us today. King Jesus, we call.
God who saves.
Amen. Good morning. Welcome to the church at Station Hill. We are so glad you're here. I had planned this morning to talk to you about maybe participating in our parking lot ministry, but I don't think I'm going to do that today. We'll save that for another time. So let me go ahead and say thank you for being here. You are so welcome. We have a number of special guests with us today. John and Avril Thomas are here from Cape Town, South Africa. You'll hear more about that later on in today's service, but we're thrilled to have them with us. If you are a guest, first time, second time, third time, whatever, if you're new to the life of our church, a special word of welcome to you. At the bottom of your bulletin is a tear-off tab. Would you do us a favor? If you are, in fact, new, just let us know that you're here. Give us your information. We'd just love to pray for you. And thank the Lord that you are here. That would be a wonderful gift to us. You can hang on to that and then just hand it to us on your way out of the service today. I'll be standing in the back and would love to get a chance to meet you. So please do that for us. We certainly would appreciate it. All right. So I think I said that as fast as humanly possible. Right? Okay, because I saw some people going. Blah, blah, blah. So, all right, now let's slow down. Take a second. Introduce yourself to someone around you and tell them welcome to the church at Station Hill.
He's worthy of our songs today. Can we read together from Exodus 15? Read with me. The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will praise him. My Father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a warrior. The Lord is his name. God, be praised this morning. Let's lift our voices together and sing to the one true God.
And oh, the Lord, our strength and song, highest praise to him belongs. Christ the Lord, our conquering King, your name we raise, your triumph sing. Oh, praise the Lord.
shall reign forever and ever. What a privilege to call on his name today. He's worthy of our songs, worthy of every note you've sung this morning. He's worthy of our prayers. And as this time in our service, as we just come to the Lord to be still before him, if you're visiting with us, we call this our prayer and altar time. It's a time for you just to call on the name of the Lord. He's faithful to answer. He's faithful to hear your prayers today. This altar is going to be open. If you'd like to come and kneel before the Lord, you're more than welcome to do that. We're not in a hurry today. There are vents blowing up here. You can dry off up here as you kneel. I mean, it's a great, it's a double win there. So we have a few things we'd love for you to pray about this morning. And obviously, you've come in with your own things that you'd like to pray about as well. But we want to continue to faithfully pray for the Unreached People Group, our focus group for the month of April, the Swahili people of Uganda. We've been praying for them all month. Not only them, but we've been praying for the Frady family, Brian and Wendy. We commissioned them, our first ever missionaries from this campus, on Easter Sunday. They're about halfway through their training at the International Mission Board right now and getting ready. It's getting really close where they'll be in Uganda ministering and evangelizing among the people that we're praying for right now. So we have so many avenues of things to pray about for the Swahili people of Uganda. So I pray this morning that the Lord will find us all faithful to lift up that family and lift up those people to the Lord. We're also so blessed, as Brandon mentioned, to have the Thomases with us today, all the way from South Africa. It's the furthest drive anyone could have driven this morning, all the way from Cape Town. And so thank you for being here. You're going to hear from John in just a few moments, and he's going to be here praying along with Jay. And I know many of you would like to come and pray over them and pray for John specifically, that God will speak through him and use him. What a great, great word he has for us today from the book of John. Actually, so it's going to be a wonderful morning together. Let's set our hearts on the Lord today. God has a specific plan for this service, and I pray that he'll speak to each of us and draw us closer to him this morning. You can be seated. Let's pray together. Moses sang these words to the Lord. He said, I will proclaim the name of the Lord. Ascribe greatness to our God, the rock. His work is perfect, for all his ways are justice. A God of faithfulness and without iniquity, just and upright is he. Lord, this same God that Moses sang about, we sing about this morning, we sing to this morning, and we pray to in these moments together. A faithful God, a mighty warrior, the Lord is his name. Lord, we are grateful that you hear our prayers today. Lord, and no doubt in a room this large, there are so many needs. And this morning, God, I pray that you would find us faithful to look to you first to meet those needs. God, that we would trust in you. You would be our strength. Lord, this morning we pray for John as he prepares to bring God's word, prepares to preach God's word. And Lord, we're so grateful for a response in our first two services. And God, we pray that you would prepare hearts in this 11 o'clock hour, this new opportunity, Lord. We know that your plans for this hour are so specific and so personal, God, and individual to each one of us. And so, Lord, would you speak in a bold and clear way to our hearts this morning. Lord, for the Swahili people of Uganda, even now, Lord, we pray for an incredible work to be done among those people. God, for the gospel to be shared among people who largely don't even know your name. And Lord, for Brian and Wendy and their kids as they're finishing up their training, Lord, and preparing to head to Uganda, Lord, would you bless them far beyond what they could ever ask or imagine? How would you give them such a fruitful ministry there? Lord, for our missions minister, Leanne Swartz and Renee Cook, who are on a plane this very moment heading to Kenya, God, I pray that you will keep them safe as they travel. Lord, give them great opportunities for ministry this week. And as they, Lord, I pray you'd give them a vision for the future as they go to make plans for other mission journeys in the future, God. Lord, this day is yours. We're so thankful for it. Lord, let us never take for granted this opportunity to join together with other believers for the one purpose of lifting up the one true God. Draw us close to you now. God, we pray these things in the strong name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen.
Good morning. Last week, we introduced you to Renee Cook, founder of Every Girl Counts, our brand new Hope for the World partner. This morning, I'm actually on an airplane headed to Kenya to serve with Every Girl Counts. We'll be scoping out some new projects and looking into ways that we can partner together in the future. But today, I just wanted to take a moment to say a big thank you to all of you who served in Engage Middle Tennessee over the last month, starting way back on March 24th with our Easter egg outreach events. And every Saturday up until yesterday, many of you were out serving in the community. So whether you were picking up trash at a local park, working at our senior living centers, serving at the MDU, or hosting a baby shower for a refugee family, thank you for extending the love of Jesus Christ all across our community. And it wasn't just here at Station Hill. Campus-wide, hundreds of people were serving all over Middle Tennessee this past weekend. Here's a video to show you some of the highlights.
Well, good morning, church family. Let me add my thank you to that of Leanne. For those of you who have served, we didn't do it just Saturday, but we've done it throughout the month of April, and almost 30 life groups, many families as well, just jumping in to participate. Over 260 people just from our campus served our community. So thank you for being the hands and feet of Jesus in tangible ways here in Middle Tennessee this past weekend. Thankfully, the Lord gave us a good weather day yesterday, unlike today. So it was great to be out there in the community yesterday. And today it's fun for me to get to connect the dots. As you've already heard, Pastor John Thomas from South Africa is going to be with us. And some of you know the story, but the Middle Tennessee Initiative of our church was inspired by John and Avril and the work that they've been doing in Cape Town, South Africa. When our senior pastor, Mike Glenn, several years ago went to go visit with John and Avril, realized the impact they were having there from this one local church getting involved in the community. That's what inspired the idea that we would have partners, each of our campuses in poverty, healthcare, and education as platform ministries in order to be able to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so it's exciting to get to have them speak to you today. Our children's minister, Taylor Johnson, this is where he served for a couple of years. So anything you don't like about our children's ministry, you can take it up with John after the service, right? No, I'm teasing. It was a formative, important time for Taylor. And he's going to be hosting the luncheon today. So if you don't have plans for lunch or if you don't want to get wet, right, just stay around. We've provided lunch for you. You can get to know John and Avril and their story better. Taylor will also be talking about the mission journey coming up later this fall. And you might want to consider that to go and serve alongside of our partners there at Living Hope. But it has been incredible to just have a front row seat since I've known them, to see the many ways that God has used this ministry. And since this is 4 weeks in John chapter 21, I knew that it would be awesome for you to hear from how God has helped John to grasp this passage. And so in just a moment, as the offering plates are being passed, we're gonna show you a video. It's actually a trailer for a documentary. A young man who's connected to our church here at Station Hill named David Kern produced a documentary about what God's doing in South Africa a few years ago. It's called Living Hope, appropriately, and it follows the stories of three people, a woman who is from South Africa, a Middle Tennessee family that attends one of our other campuses that was there as missionaries for a while, and of course, John. But it will give you a context and some pictures of the context of ministry in which they serve. So as our ushers come to take our tithes and offerings, let's be faithful with the opportunities that God has presented to us. Will you join me as we pray? Father, I thank you for such a great morning to gather inside. We're grateful for a roof above our head and that you have provided that, and that we could worship you today in spirit and in truth. Thank you for the songs, the prayers, the community, and most importantly, your spirit. And may that same spirit that unifies us now, God, open our hearts and our minds to be challenged from your word. So be with your servant, John, as he brings it. And Father, just as you are always faithful to us, may we be faithful in our response with all that you've entrusted to us as we now gladly give it back in the forms of tithes and offerings to make much of Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
The poverty is horrendous in this area. The disease burden is very high. In cases, in a sample of 1 in 2 who are HIV positive.
I've heard it said, never pity missionaries. If anything, envy them, because they are given ringside seats to see some of God's greatest activity in the world.
I just somehow thought all I needed to do was help Jesus save souls. And then I discovered, as I read the Word of God, I was wrong. Jesus wanted me to help save people.
Good morning, my name is Leonie. I'm a recovered drug addict.
Leonie touched me very deeply, her sincerity of wanting help.
I've got to get some answers. I've got to know what I'm here for.
But I remember this peace that came and feeling like, okay, Lord, we can do this.
We figured out that we had to do something with the medical side of the work.
Anybody can come to that hospital and be treated.
A place like Living Hope, is there a better name?
I've been battling with the knowledge of one of my mentees. They're losing their 37-year-old wife to breast cancer.
Whatever is happening to me, I surrender everything to God.
If I could, I'd have brought everybody over here that gave Clifford something so that they could see how he reacted. That's what life's all about.
We as Christians need to be the solution, not standing on the sideline.
Well, Station Hill Church family, would you join me in welcoming John Thomas?
Thank you so much to Pastor Jay and Pastor Cliff. I know I'm the one who speaks funny and say pastor, not pasta or whatever, not that Italian food, but something like that. But it's wonderful to be with you, Station Hill. It's really great to come and share with you the Word of God, and I count it a great privilege, and thanks to the leadership team for giving me the opportunity of preaching on a passage I have never preached on until this morning. I have had a long flight and sometime yesterday to prepare the sermon, and I really believe that this is for you. There are folk here today that God has got an appointment with. And it's following through on what you've been doing in John 21. And we're just going to pick up the story where you had it last week. But just to reemphasize exactly where we are, let's pick up in John 21 from verse 15. When they had finished, had eaten breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said to him. "You know that I love you." "Feed my lambs," he told him. A second time he asked him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" "Yes, Lord," he said to him. "You know that I love you." "Shepherd my sheep," he told him. He asked him a third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was grieved that he asked him a third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Feed my sheep," Jesus said. "Truly," now this is where we pick it up today, "I tell you that when you were younger, you would tie your belt and walk wherever you wanted. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands." Now, commentators believe those words, "stretch out your hands," was an indication of crucifixion, that you would stretch out your hands like this and actually carry the crucifixion crossbar. And someone else will tie you and carry you where you don't want to go. He said this to indicate the kind of death that Peter would glorify God, this crucifixion. After saying this, he told him, "Follow me." So Peter turned around, and obviously John is behind, and saw the disciple Jesus loved following them, the one who leaned back against Jesus at the supper, and asked, "Lord, who's the one who's going to betray you?" Still referring to John there. When Peter saw him, John, he said to Jesus, "Lord, what about him?" "If I want him to remain until I come," Jesus answered, "what is that to you? As for you, follow me," or I really like what the NIV version has, "what is that to you? As for you, you must follow me," is the way in which the NIV has translated that last line. You must follow me. I think Jesus had some fun in a way crafting this chapter, John 21. Crafting the night before when they went out fishing and all the way through. Because in a masterly way, Jesus completely recreates at least three scenes of deja vu for Peter in his last 3 years of ministry. And you know, deja vu is that feeling like I've been here before. It's a sort of recollection. And it's almost like Jesus is saying, "Okay, Peter, here's a lesson. It's going to be one huge recap of your life and ministry and my words to you." So here we go with deja vu number one, the big catch of fish. You would have seen 2 weeks, 3 weeks back, where Jesus comes in the early morning and says, "Throw the net out on the other side." And there's this huge catch of fish. Well, back in Luke chapter 5, they've been out all night. Jesus gets into the boat and starts to preach from the boat to the crowds and then finishes preaching and then says to Peter, none other than the same guy, "Peter, push out into the deep. We're going to go fishing." Peter says, "Hey, listen, Lord, you stick to preaching, I stick to fishing. I know what's going on. There are no fish out there." His exact words, "Master, we have toiled all night and we haven't caught a thing. What do you know about fishing?" Jesus says, "Out you go, throw out the nets." And there is this huge haul of fish. They've got to call the neighboring boat in to get extra help. And Jesus says to Peter in his mind, okay, deja vu number one, this big catch of fish. They've been out there all night. Peter was not meant to go back fishing. Now, Galilee is like, it isn't quite 100 miles, but let's just, for the sake of convenience, like 100 miles from Jerusalem. And Jesus has specifically said to them, stay in Jerusalem until the promise of my Father comes, which was the promised Holy Spirit, the day of Pentecost. What's Peter done? I'm not sticking around in Jerusalem. Jesus hasn't showed up. This promise doesn't seem to be. I'm going home, guys. I'm going fishing. Who's going to join me? And then Jesus says, throw the net on the other side. And there's this familiar voice. And then there's this familiar scene of this massive haul of fish. And then Peter realizes it's the Lord. And then he's in the water. This time, no walking on the water stuff, you know, none of that. He's in, swims across to Jesus, and has a few seconds or minutes alone with him on the beach. I often wonder what happened then. What did he say? It's the first time he's alone with Jesus after the denials. I've got a feeling it was, I'm sorry. Lord, I'm so sorry. But that's the first scene of deja vu that Jesus creates. The next scene is similar for Peter's restoration as it was for his denial. It is around a public charcoal fire, both times with three questions. Very interesting. This charcoal fire is only referred to twice in the New Testament. Once at his denial, just a couple of weeks ago. And now again, Jesus, in his masterly way, recreates a charcoal fire. Puts a fish, we'd say braai, a fish barbecue on there, but there's this charcoal fire, there's people around, the disciples around. And just as there were three questions, do you know this man? No, I don't. Do you know this man? I swear I don't. I curse, I don't know him. Three questions. Jesus comes back in this deja vu, round the fire. Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you really love me? Same scene. What must have been going on in Peter's mind? Lord, what are you doing to me? Around that fire, he denied Jesus. But now around this fire, he's recommissioned and offered restoration. But the third deja vu is his calling and commissioning. It's the same follow me words in the same place. Now let me just explain to you. They're really on the same beach as they've always been. Because here somewhere near Capernaum, that's where Peter lives, they've got the boats pulled up on the beach, and their house would have been, you know, 100 feet or 200 feet from the water's edge. And that's where the boats always lived. That was their dock, so to say, for their boats. So we're back on the same beach with the boats pulled up in the same place as we were in Matthew 4:19. Where Jesus comes along and says, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And the Bible says, and at once they left their nets and they followed him. Here we are again. What are the words Jesus uses for Peter here? Follow me, verse 19. Verse 22 again. You must follow me. I mean, it's deja vu. All these words are ringing. Jesus has recreated so many scenes for Peter of his life. And they're all meshed into this final moment of restoration and commissioning into getting back onto God's agenda. God renewed his call to Peter. And today, God renews his call to you and to you and to you. I believe that you are here today by divine appointment to hear what the Lord has to say to you. And I trust you're going to hear the clear voice of Jesus confirming a call on your life to follow him into ministry and missions, no matter the cost. Now, just like Peter, we have various ways of following. And what I want to do this morning is to look at five ways in which Peter followed, because we do the same thing in our following. Following firstly, but doing it your way. The fact that you're here today is an indicator to me that in some measure you're a follower of Jesus. You may be a very fully devoted follower of Jesus. On the other hand, you might sort of be, not too sure about this. I think I score a 1 out of 10 on following. But you're here because to some measure you're either seeking to follow or you are a follower of Jesus. But maybe like Peter, you're saying, you know what? I'm going to do it my way. I mean, Jesus has been very specific about the instructions, stick around in Jerusalem. Peter has said, blow that. I'm not going to do that type of following. I'm going home. I'm going back to making money the way I know money. I'm going to be familiar and do the familiar. I'm going to do it my way. I think maybe Peter had somehow, or maybe Frank Sinatra got the idea from Peter, but in his song, I Did It My Way, that first verse goes, I've lived a life that's full, I've traveled each and every highway, but much, much more than this, I did it. Exactly. And that's how we follow, isn't it? Lord, I'll follow on my terms. I want to follow. I'll follow my way. You know what Peter found? Going back to the old familiar way didn't work. I mean, he spent the whole night out there and didn't even catch one tiny little fish. But still, we stick with doing it my way. Get real. Start following God's way. Let me say to you, to a certain extent, as I look back on my life and ministry, I wonder what I missed out on, because at times I might have been doing my own thing. As my wife Avril and I were driving out here this morning, we were talking about that and saying it is very possible to follow Jesus and be in full-time ministry and still do things your way because you think they're good. We need a little bit of this holy fear of missing out. You know the social media FOMO thing, fear of missing out? I want to tell you, in our followership of Jesus, we need some holy FOMO. We need to be absolutely fearless about our following and fearful that we may in some way, by doing our own thing, be missing out on some of the plan that God has for us. Stop following and doing it your way. You're wasting your time and energy. In fact, following but doing it your way is hardly following at all. But another type of following that Peter did was following but comparing. Following but comparing. If you look at John 21:22, Jesus answered, if I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? What is that to you? You must follow me. In other words, Peter, you know what? Don't worry about John's form of service, other people's form of service. Your service for me, Peter, is going to be different. And you know what? God has not made you all to be Pastor Jay or Pastor Cliff or Pastor Taylor or whoever. Leanne, God has made you unique, with a unique identity and a unique purpose. And God will use you uniquely in a way that is aligned to your personality and your gifts and your life and your experience. So don't get into this comparison game in ministry, because it's big in Christian world. We play this game in the Christian world, and Christian leadership play it particularly well. It's called, not Game of Thrones, but Game of Comparisons. And I want to tell you, if you can invent an app called Game of Comparisons for Christian ministry, you're going to be a millionaire, but I want half the profits for Living Hope because I gave you the idea. So this is how the Game of Comparisons work. Lord, why is his church bigger than my church? Why is the worship down there better than ours up here? Why is their missions better? Why can't we do it this way? Why? We rank these things. And Peter played this game and sort of said, Lord, what about this guy, John? And Jesus' blunt words were, none of your business. You follow me. And that's sweet to my ears. Because I tell you, you can scan the Christian world and you can get into this stuff. Lord, how come, you know, Dallas Willard is a better thinker than I am? How come John Piper preaches better than I do? And there's this avalanche of Christian comparisons. Book after book, conference after conference, you're quietly getting the message. Preaching could be better. Your worship could be better. Your evangelism could be better. Your caring for the poor and the needy could be better. Your missions could be better. Your children's ministry could be better. Your youth could be better. And so I'm refreshed by the blunt words of Jesus to you and me. What is that stuff to you? You must follow me. Stop this following by comparing. So to whom are you comparing yourself? You know what? I'm so glad I don't live in this area. Because one of the things that I have seen about this area is the immense challenge of keeping up with the Franklinites, if there is such a word, and the Brentwoodites. Because, you know, maybe we should be like them. And there is this game of comparisons. Their kids are at a better school than our kids. And, you know, they've got a nicer house and a bigger house and a better car. And there is this pressure that you guys live in to be like them or to be better than them or to be equal than them. And there is so much that you must apparently compare yourself by. Hear Jesus' blunt words. What is that stuff to you? You must just get on with following me. That's what you got to do. Stop this following but comparing stuff. Third one, style of Peter following, is following after forsaking. Following after forsaking. These moments for Peter must have been some of indelible shame. I mean, he's followed Jesus so closely. Jesus has said, you know what, Peter, your brashness and your stuff, you're going to deny me. Oh, never, not me. Half this crowd of disciples, Lord, but not me. And then he puts his foot in so deep. I mean, he's even swearing and cursing. Now, I never know the same. Don't go after me like that. I mean, this is big time forsaking. This is not just little average. Whew, I blew that a little, didn't I? No, I mean, this was blowing it big time. Complete denial. I even know this Jesus. If I'd been Peter and I see Jesus out there on the shore, I'd be thinking, now I'm in for a mouthful. I mean, now I'm going to get it. I'm going to get rejection. I'm going to get moaned. I'm going to get told out, you know, I told you so. Sort of like a husband after his wife or a wife after his husband. I told you so, it's not going to work. That type of thing. Does Peter get that? Not at all. Nothing. Instead of rejection, he gets restoration. Instead of rejection, he gets recommissioned into ministry. What grace, what mercy. And here's a word that I really feel that God gave me for someone here today, for some of you here today. It's a word just simply rephrased around what Jesus said to Peter. My child, I have come here today to seek you out. I'm eager to restore you, though you turned away and forsook me. I know you're going back to your old way of life. And today I come to you just as I came to Peter. I come looking for you today. I come calling you today. I've come to fully restore you and recommission you. My child, peace be to you. Stop the worry and pain and receive my peace. My child, do you really, really love me? I've not given up on you, says the Lord. But you've been disappointed in me. If you really love me, then today I've come to restore you. And even more, I've come to fill you and call you back to serve me. I am eager to forgive, restore, and commission you. Now, follow me. You must follow me. Maybe that's for you. Maybe you're even serving in some aspect of mission or ministry. Then you've left it because of some or other circumstances where God disappointed you in your feeling, or there was a family and a relationship issue, or there was a financial issue, and you just sort of, oh God, I'm not doing this stuff anymore, I can't. You can still follow after forsaking. There's the grace of God. You can still follow after falling. That's the mercy of God. We have our little lists in the Christian world that are sometimes cruel. You did that, bang, out of ministry, gone forever, signed to the Christian rubbish dump. Thankfully, that's not the mercy that Jesus shows. You can follow after you've forsaken. Hear him call you today. Come, follow me. But the fourth one of following is a hard one. Following in the face of death. Following in the face of death. Jesus' final words, as far as we know, recorded to Peter were, "You must follow me." But implicit in them was this prophetic word about being a martyr. Peter will follow Jesus to the cross. And Peter's somewhere in his mid to late 30s, they tell us. He's probably got another 30 years of life and serving God ahead of him. And this sword of Damocles, as it were, hangs over his head, that one day a bar will be stretched out across his hands and he will follow down his road to his Golgotha, his Via Dolorosa, all the way where he will be crucified. And Tertullian, the historian, tells us that that is exactly what happened to Peter. He was crucified for the sake of Jesus Christ. But history records that he refused to be crucified the way his Lord and Master was, and asked to be crucified upside down. He followed all the way to the cross. This is the guy who forsook and said, I don't know you. And my friend, this is one of the hardest sermons to preach, because I'm calling you today to come and die for Jesus. Because that's what this sermon is about. That's what this passage is about. You can't skirt around it. That's the beauty of expository preaching. You cover everything. Well, today, I'm calling you to come and die for Jesus if necessary. Because that's what Peter was called to. You must follow me all the way to the cross. In the face of death, you must follow me. It's a hard call. It's not exactly sort of following Jesus in first class aeroplane travel. There may be significant dangers ahead for you. There may be terrible trials of health and family that go wrong. There may be the costly separation of parents and grandparents for your kids. There may be a huge cost in following Jesus. The highest cost of dying for Christ. Some of you maybe need to say today, I will follow you, Lord, even if it means I'm going to die for you. It's a sobering thing to be told by your master and friend that you will die in his service. But Jesus says much the same. You know, they'll lay hands on you, they'll persecute you, they'll put some of you to death. And while I was preparing this sermon, I was saying to myself, John, don't preach this stuff. I mean, nobody's going to come forward, because who calls people to come out and die potentially for Jesus? It's not this sort of soft, easy, comfort call, you know, just give a little bit more, 10 minutes of your time to God each week. This is for your life that God is calling you today. This is not play around time anymore. This is serious business that the Lord of the harvest says, come, follow me, you must, even if it means to being a martyr. Go to a Middle Eastern country and maybe have your head chopped off because you're following me. Go to China, because in the last 2-3 weeks, there's a brand new persecution. You can follow it on reputable websites of the church in China. Last Saturday, there was a pastor in Cape Town from a church in China whose mission we support, back at King of Kings. And on Saturday, his wife got a message from the secret police. This is first-hand, accurate, truthful, saying the secret police are visiting the church tomorrow to close it down. So the wife and the husband were in touch with each other, and very sharply and shrewdly, when the secret police got there, there was nobody in the building. They had got the message in the entire church, and they had all met in groups of 9 and 10. And my guess is the same things happened this Sunday. That church got broken up like this. Persecution for Jesus, my friend. And that may be what God is calling you to. In a sense, I hope it isn't. But this is the call today. Come, follow me, even in the face of death, all the way to martyrdom. And finally, following but holding on to nets. Following but holding on to nets. I have found that most of my failures and others' failures in Christian leadership come from when we cease to be good followers of Jesus, when we stick to him and follow closely and try and catch every ball he throws, when God in his gracious mercy adds blessing to that. I was pastoring a church. I didn't know the first thing about healthcare. Not one thing. Let alone about AIDS and tuberculosis, which is a pandemic now that has broken out across our city. It's bigger than HIV and AIDS, tuberculosis. And we're right in the middle of that. What do I know about that? All I know is as a pastor of a local church, that last year we physically touched over 47,000 people in healthcare to whom we delivered healthcare for zero. Didn't cost the person a cent. Every one of those people we were able to pray with and minister to and tell them about Jesus. And just in recent weeks, Living Hope has had an outpouring of the blessing of God upon it in a way that I've really seen. We've seen many, many come to Christ. This service has got a bit more time, so I can snatch an extra minute or two. About 2 weeks ago, we had a service for orphans. We got nearly 1,800 orphans in our program. But there were 90 of these orphans that had gone through grief care. I'm talking about kiddies. And their caregivers came with to the service of celebrating. Now, these caregivers could be distant family members or not. And the gospel was simply preached. I didn't preach. But then our chaplain, as they often do in Africa, called me up and said, you know, Pastor, you can make an invitation type of thing. And I just said, some of you need to come to Jesus today. And you need to come out in the front. And I thought, well, nobody's going to come. These little children started to come. These caregivers started to come. Tears streaming down their eyes. 22 orphans and caregivers gave their life to Jesus. We've seen so much of the blessing of God. But that's because by the grace of God, we sought to follow in a land of unknowns. And God in his mercy and grace has honored those small steps of obedience. What is Peter's primary call, the first call? Let's go back to that beach near his home, Matthew 4:18. Jesus said, Peter, follow me and I will make you fishers of men. What's that? It's the call to evangelism. What happened 2-3 weeks after this recommissioning, the day of Pentecost? Peter got up. He preached his first ever sermon in public. The same man who 6 weeks before has been cursing, I never know him. He preached his message, and how many came to know Christ? Any of you know the answer? 3,000, that's it. A few weeks later, he preaches another message. 5,000 come to know the Lord. I mean, even Billy Graham, I don't know if he hit that in his first ever evangelistic message. The second one, 5,000. I mean, extraordinary. You see, because Jesus said, Peter, follow me and I'll do the making. You do the following, I will make you a fisher of men. And what a gifted evangelist. Peter, then Jesus says to him, last week you heard that, feed my sheep. What happens? He turns into the most amazing pastor. Read Peter's epistles and you see how this guy really knew and cared for his flock and challenged his flock to be shepherds of God's flock, and even in the face of persecution. What a pastor! This is the guy who blew it. Big time. Isn't God's grace wonderful? I love it. Whoops, there I go. My time's done, apparently. But Right now, back on the beach, what's Peter just done? Gone back to his nets. He's saying, you know what, Jesus, you didn't pitch up. So I'm going back to doing what I'm familiar with. I need money. I'm going to go make some money because I know how to make money out of fish, even if there's no catch. But Jesus says basically to him, fish by ZBD and Sons is going to close. The familiar is going to go. And for some of you, you've got to get rid of those familiar nets that you're holding on to. The net of that relationship that has got you caught. The net of the financial security that your job gives you to keep up with the lifestyle that you can't afford to keep up with, but you want it because you want to look a bit better than somebody else. The net of family security. The net of comparing yourself with somebody else because, you know, it looks better than what you do. Let go of those nets. The ropes are burning your hands as you seek to hold on to them and hold on to them. And Jesus says to you today, drop them. They are burning your hands. You must follow me. You must follow me. And so a closing question. Is what you're living for worth dying for? Is what you're living for right now, my friend, really worth dying for? And if not, Jesus calls you to follow him. He's worth dying for. I'm going to invite you to come. It's no fancy. Close your eyes and stick your hands up here. Cliff is going to come and lead us in a song about forsaking all. I'm going to come down front and other counselors, Jay, will be here. I want to invite you. Listen, this is a costly call. But if God has been speaking to you today, I don't care whether you're 75 or 5. You need to respond to the word of God today. You need to say, Lord, I'm willing to follow you. I don't know where, I don't know when, but I'm willing to follow wherever on your terms. And so I want you to come up as a start of obedience in that followership as we stand and sing this final song.
Before the throne, I stand.
still repeat. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Jesus paid.
Such a powerful question for us to answer today. Is what we're living for worth dying for? And so if you need to respond in any way, John will continue to be here. I will continue to be here. Our other decision counselors are coming now to join us. So there are plenty of people for you to talk and pray with as you respond to the work of the Word in your heart and in your life today. So grateful for John and Avril and for their faithfulness. Again, if you want to stay for lunch, we'll be up in the student area in just a few moments. But if you need to connect with anybody in any way, don't leave this place, as God's Spirit is evidently moving today. So don't leave until you've prayed or talked with someone. And so church, as we know, we pray that we will be obedient to those two words that Jesus said, follow me. So you are loved and you are sent. Have an awesome Sunday.